general, some of the bars are different.
I come out of here with a suntan, with a suntan.
Or losing a couple of pounds.
If you're too warm, you can take your jacket off.
I don't want to take one jacket off. Thanks.
It's all week.
12th January 1995, survivor Mr. Pinchas Gutter, interviewer Larry Silverberg in Toronto, Canada, in English. Tape one, please state your name and your age.
My name is Pinchas Gutter. My age is 62 years old.
Mr. Gutter, would you please start by telling us a little about what your life was like before the war started, where you were born, and what your parents did, that type of thing.
I was born in Lodz in 1932 into a Hasidic family. My parents, my father, my grandfather, as a matter of fact, in our family, the tradition was that we had the same occupation for the last 400 years before this Second World War. And we were all winemakers. And my father and my grandfather together owned the largest winery in Poland.
Did you have a large family?
Our family was, the extended family numbered between 150 and 200 people that I knew personally, because we used to get together on quite, you know, we all lived in Lodz, and I had uncles and aunts and great uncles and grandfathers and on my mother's side and my father's side. And I would say that the immediate family was anything between 150 and 200 people. I can't remember exactly at what stage. I mean, I'm not sure what you want me to say exactly.
Basically, I just want you to describe your life a little bit.
Well, we lived a very religious life. My mother's parents were farmers, which is unusual for Jews in Poland, because Jews weren't allowed to farm, but somehow or other, I'm not quite sure how they managed to do that, but they owned farms near the German border. So I don't know whether it was a leftover from the Austro-Hungarian Empire, but whatever. And they also were Gerech Hasidim, so they were ultra-Orthodox Jews. And our life was very uneventful before the war. We worked. I went to Cheder when I was 5 years old. I already finished the five books of Moses and I started studying the Talmud. I went to school when I was 2.5 years old. My grandfather took me with a bag of sweets and distributed to all the children, and that's how I started my schooling. I don't know if that's of any importance, but we were very close to the Gera Rebbe, and a lot of my life was spent in the entourage, like summer vacations were spent in a dasha in a place called Vishnova Gura, where my parents, well, my mother and the immediate family were there the whole week. My father used to come for weekends on Friday and spend and used to go back to town on Sunday. And we used to go and pray in the woods. I mean, the real Hasidic way of living. I spent a lot of time with my mother. My mother was more secular educated. She went to the gymnasium, which was unusual for a Hasidic wife. And that's where I learned perfect Polish before the war, which was also unusual for a Hasidic little boy. You only learned Polish much later. My father did not speak a good Polish. Life wasn't a bed of roses from a point of view. Antisemitism before the war wasn't a bed of roses either. I mean, I remember quite clearly walking in Lodz with my mother, and because I was wearing Hasidic garb, which was, you know, a little hat with payas, I often had to walk across. My mother would take me across the other side, because they would be unruly type of individual hooligans, or it's the way she called them in Yiddish, a hooligan, who would come and pull my payers or kick me or something like that, and it which was, you know, quite frightening in its own way. And I can tell you some incidents. When in 1937 I became very ill, and I had double pneumonia, which was before the war. It was almost a fatal disease in Poland. But fortunately for me, we had a doctor who found out that there was such a thing as sulfur drugs, and he got them from Vienna, because I don't think that in Poland before the war they had pharmacies that had had the best type of drugs. And that started, and I was ill for many months, and that started me on the road to recovery. But my lungs were so weakened that for a long time I was ill. And I was sent into the mountains to spend some time in a non-Jewish environment amongst some people, mountain people, Polish mountain people that are called Gurale. Gura is a mountain in Polish. Gurale means mountain people. And I lived in a hut with the animals and everything, the way these people lived, all by myself. And my mother came later, but when I was by myself, I used to do a lot of walking in the mountains. And although I was very young, I remember quite clearly those mountains in a place called Szczawnice, around Szczawnice. And in Szczawnice itself, they had a park. And in summer, they used to have orchestras, all dressed in white. I don't know if they were military or municipal or whatever, but they were orchestras that used to entertain the crowds. And I used to go down. I was very musical, and I was very interested in music, and I liked all kinds of music. And after the concert, I was walking back to the hut where I came from, and I passed a church, which is Catholic, because most churches in Poland were cathedrals or Catholic churches. And they were conducting the Sunday, it wasn't a Sunday, they were conducting Sunday evening service. And the music was very beautiful. You know, they were singing, there was choir, organ and everything. And I knew that I couldn't go inside. I mean, that would have been unheard of for a little Jewish boy to go inside. But I stood outside and got so wrapped up in the music that I actually kind of fell on my knees, and I was like crouching there listening to this music, until suddenly I got an enormous clap. Somebody hit me from behind, you know, in my head with their hand, but really very painfully, and shouted at me, how dare this, you know, I don't want to use the four-letter word that he used, but I still remember it. I mean, I was a little boy, but I still remember the words he used, you know, defiled the steps of a Catholic church or Polish church. So anti-Semitism was nothing new to me, but it was obviously nothing that I experienced in the Holocaust.
Did you feel that your family was more of an affluent family, or were they more?
They were very affluent.
They were affluent.
Yeah, I had I was a twin. My sister and I, we were twins. We were the only children of our parents. My mother nearly died in childbirth, and she couldn't have children afterwards. I'm not quite sure what happened, but she couldn't have children afterwards. And both my sister and I, we had separate maids looking after. So we must have been very affluent. I remember always having a woman, a Jewish woman, who would like look after me, take me to the park, and you know, that was before I went to school. I'm talking about when I was two or three. You know, I've got memories going back a long time.
Do you think because of the family position of affluence that you were insulated from anti-Semitism that might perhaps have been rampant to lower income
well,
families?
I was insulated to a certain extent because I lived in a large city, and large, as you know, I'm sure you're aware, had a huge Jewish population. Most of the Jews living in Lodz were workers. They weren't rich people. They worked in the textile industry, they worked in metal and other industries, but Lodz was a big textile center. And I remember opposite, although we lived in one of the main streets of Lodz, opposite us was a weaving and a spinning factory. And when I looked out of my window, we were in the apartment where we lived, I would see Jews and, you know, in payas and beards wearing a tzitzikamfas. I don't know whether you know what a tzitzikamfas is. It's fringes, a garment with fringes, and standing and working by the machines, spinning and weaving.
In Lodz at the time, were the Jews not ghettoized, but were they in one general area where they lived, or were they spread out throughout the city?
I'm not sure, but I would say that they were reasonably well spread. There may have been areas. I know that, for example, in our apartment, that apartment still belongs to me. We've got a big, huge apartment block in the center of Lodz and other buildings which actually belong to me. And my cousin, who survived also, is in Israel. He's got all the title deeds and things. I'm not doing anything about that. But the fact is that there were mostly Jews living in that apartment. And I remember on a Saturday, we used to go and take the children to the baker. You know, Friday we used to take it, and then Saturday after the services we used to collect it. And there were a lot of Jews in Zachodnia Ulitsa, that's where we lived, in Zachodnia number 54. So, and I did not come into contact with non-Jews except with a guy that worked in the building. He was the supervisor, the building supervisor. He was not Jewish, he had an apartment there. He lived there with his wife and children. And they were quite friendly. Except, I could tell you a story, anticipate what happened after the war. My cousin survived Warsaw with his wife and child. It's a long story, which I'm not going to tell you. But he came back to Lodz after the war, and he went to our building to see what happened there. And he went to our apartment, knocked on the door, and the woman that opened the door was the wife of the superintendent. She told him that her husband had died during the war. She also told him, and she was living in our apartment, she also told him that she recognized him, and she knows that he is a nephew of Pan Mandela. My father's name was Mendel. And because Pan Mandel was such a nice man to work for and was such a nice man, they will not kill him now. That was in 1945. But if he ever comes back and sets foot in the apartment or in the building, she'll see to it that he won't get out alive. That was in 1945, after he survived the Germans.
That seemed to be the general feeling, I assume, of the Gentile Polish population, not only after the war, but certainly before the war,
I don't know about before the war, because I was too young to be able to tell you. But what I can tell you is that during the war, after the war I wasn't in Poland, so I don't know, but I know enough what I've heard, but from my own experiences, I don't know what happened after the war in Poland. But during the war, I experienced far worse antisemitism from Poles than from Germans, because the feeling that you got in Poland during the war, that the Germans were doing, I mean, it was inhuman, and they were doing a job. Whether they liked it or they didn't like it wasn't important, but they were doing a job. It was almost like factory machine killing. But the Poles enjoyed it.
We return a little bit. We'll come to that. But let's like to speak a little bit more about your childhood. Do you recall when, or did you have any perception as 1939 grew closer that things were changing or for your family? Can you describe
Very
that?
Much so. Because, first of all, I was a very precocious individual. So I used to read the newspapers regularly, both Yiddish and and Polish newspapers. And what was happening in Germany to Jews was quite clear to everybody in Poland. And then there was when things were getting worse, they dumped a lot of Polish Jews on the border between Poland and Germany. The Germans didn't want them because they said they were Polish. The Poles didn't want to accept them because they weren't prepared to have people dumped on them. And these people were no man's land for quite some time. I don't remember, but I remember that aspect of that particular happening. And I also remember that I don't think that from about 1936 onwards, because I think before that I was too small. But from the time that I actually kind of started going to cheder, going to school and be involved and listening, there wasn't a day that Hitler and his minions were not discussed in my home and what is going to happen. As a matter of fact, my parents wanted very much to go to Israel, to Palestine, because we had vineyards in Israel from which we used to bring the juice of which wine was made in Poland, in Hungary and in Israel. We had Pardesim. My grandfather owned Pardesim in Israel. And my father and my mother particularly wanted to go to Israel. And so there were discussions about that. But my grandfather wouldn't let them because he went a couple of times. The last time was in 1938. And he said that we must wait till the Messiah will come because he was a Hasidic Jew. And he didn't like the secular Zionist attitude. When he went to his fields or wherever, he saw young Jewish women working in shorts, and which was contrary to all Hasidic and Orthodox halachi law. So he felt that this was an ungodly thing to do, is to go from Poland, where you could live, you know, isolated in a Jewish Hasidic community, and then go to Palestine. So it was definitely, and it built up to a crescendo in the sense that people were getting more and more nervous about what is going to happen. People were talking about leaving, about staying. I mean, these discussions I remember quite clearly when they were being held in our home.
Did any of your relatives decide to leave?
Some relatives went, I found, in Israel, but they went, I think, independent of what was going on in Germany. I think they went because they wanted to emigrate to Israel for religious reasons, because they were all living in Bnei Brak, and they wanted to do Aliyah to Israel, but as a religious experience. I don't think it had anything to do with politics or the situation in Poland that I remember from my own personal family. Most of my family, I would say 95%, stayed, and the majority of them, except four cousins, survived the war out of a couple of hundred people.
You know, four cousins survived, the rest perished, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
So obviously you were very aware that things were heating up on the political scene. Do you remember when the war started? When the invasion actually commenced in September.
I remember it very well. I was in a train. I was coming home from Szczawnica. Actually, we had kind of changed trains in Krakow. And as we were going towards Lodz, I don't remember if it was the first day of the war, the second day of the war, I don't have that memory. But I remember the aeroplanes, you know, the Messerschmitts strafing the train as it was riding. And I remember the train stopping several times and passengers going off into the ditches. So that was quite a traumatic experience. It was my mother and my sister and I. We had been in Szczawnica, and then we went to visit our grandparents in Wielun, which was a little, and we left, I think, a couple of days before the war started, but somehow or other it took, I don't know whether we stopped in Krakow, I don't remember exactly, but we were caught in the train when the war started. And when we got home, my father was very nervous and upset because he hadn't heard anything from my mother's parents. And then he heard that Wielun was already in the German hands in the first few hours, and didn't know what happened. But the Germans apparently were kicking out the population to go in front of them. So it was a 2-3 days where in our home was like Yom Kippur, because everybody was praying and crying. Nobody knew what happened to my mother's family. And eventually they kind of walked and they actually came and stayed with us in our apartment. And they arrived either just after the Germans came into Lodz or just before, I don't remember exactly. But this was all happening, you know, during the beginning when the war was on, and although Lodz wasn't bombarded, I certainly remember when the Germans came in, because they the first thing they did is they started rounding up Jewish notables. And my grandfather was one of the Jewish notables. He was the Rosh Machzikei Adat. He was one of the Jewish notables of the town. And he was also obviously a very wealthy man and well known. But he was ill and he was lying in bed. He just had an operation on kidney stones. The SS came into our house and they were going to take him away. Well, when they saw him, how ill he was, they decided not to. But my father was there, so the next best thing is they took him. They took him down. That was why the war was still going on. It was just in the first few days. They took him down to our wine cellars, which were on Novomieska. And I suppose they made him take the keys. They opened the wine cellars, and then the army trucks that were coming, going towards the front or coming from the front, they were pulling out bottles, all the bottles of wine, and taking the barrels out. And apparently, for several days, they were pulling these out. And apparently, there were, my cousins tell me that, I don't know of my own, that there were millions and millions of bottles, because we had a huge, huge concern. And these cellars go back over 100 years in the particular spot where they were. So there were wines there that were, you know, old, and barrels, you know, of thousands of liters, huge barrels. That I remember, because I'd been in that cellar many times. My father started training me to become a wine maker. And we were beside ourselves and concerned. And the Germans thought that they've killed my father, because they beat him to within an inch of his life, or at least they thought they killed him, and they threw him down the stairs in the cellar, and he was lying at the end unconscious. The caretaker that worked for the winery, at night there was a lull in the trucks and there was nobody there, so he went down to have a look what was going on, and he saw that my father was breathing. He put him on his shoulders and he carried him all the way to our apartment, and he brought him there. And apparently the Germans beat him, really, because he was unconscious for several days. But fortunately at the time, he recovered his consciousness. And then it was decided that because of what happened, that we wouldn't stay in Lodz. And first my father started making some arrangements while he was still in bed, for us to leave. Then we couldn't leave, and eventually when Poland was completely taken over by the Germans and the Russians and trains started going, my mother and my sister and I were blonde and blue-eyed. We spoke pure Polish like the Poles, could easily dress up and look like Poles. So I remember the scene in our apartment when they tried to cut my payas, and I was crying bitter tears because, you know, this was my life. You know, this was my identity. But they cut my hair off, you know, all this hair that was here, the big chunk, and they shaved this so it really should look like a non-Jewish child. And my sister had long golden plaits, so she was fine. And we went down to the railway and we bought tickets and we went to Warsaw. My father, who was dark and wasn't well yet, couldn't use the train because Jews were already not allowed to travel by train. He only arrived several months later in Warsaw by smuggling himself through the border, because they divided Poland between the government general and the Reich. You know, Lodz was annexed, and they changed the name. It was called Litzmannstadt, and my father was in the German, or kind of the German part. And the occupied Polish part, there was a border. So he smuggled himself on foot and with, you know, peasants and stuff like that for several months until he came to Warsaw.
You left all your belongings in Lodz?
We had a couple of suitcases with us, but everything was left in Lodz, yeah.
And in Warsaw, how were you able to set up a home there?
My youngest aunt the one that I have a photograph of, who I found in Israel, she married a Jew in Warsaw. And Vovo Spiegelglas, and so they were the only family that I knew that lived in Warsaw. He was a Warsaw man. And they had a very large apartment, and we went from the station straight to their apartment until such time that my father came, we lived with them.
Were you able to transfer funds in order for you to survive?
My father must have been extremely wealthy, because I don't remember suffering from hunger in the Warsaw, even in the ghetto. So whether he had money, or whether he had jewels, or whether he had whatever he had, he must have had some wealth, because although we lived very modestly, but at least we didn't perish in the ghetto itself from hunger. And when I was sick, again, you know, he had enough funds to be able to get a doctor and get horse meat, which I wouldn't eat because it wasn't kosher, and I was forced to drink the soup to build my strength up. So I don't think that that there were great problems from the point of view. He must have brought sufficiently with him.
Were the rest of your relatives, your whole extended family, they were still back in Lodz?
They all stayed in Lodz. None of them came to Warsaw.
And when your father came to Warsaw, was he well enough to work, or was he still?
Well, he was well enough to work, but there wasn't much he could do. He started off by opening a little sweet shop. I'm not quite sure what that was all about, but he did. I don't know whether he made any living out of it, but I suppose he had to do something. But that was right in the beginning.
Was the ghetto set up in Warsaw at this point, or was?
No. The ghetto, when we came in 1939, the ghetto was closed, if I remember correctly, towards the end of 1940. So it was at least a year and more. And by that time, we had already, my father, after he came, after several months, the winter of 39 and 40 was a very difficult winter. And that winter, we were without my father. So we were at least 3-4 months without my father. When he arrived, he started looking around for a place of our own. And he found in a partly bombed building on Nalewki 49, part of it was standing. He found a two-roomed apartment. It was a bedroom and a kitchen. And we moved in there. And while we were there, lots of things happened. And I don't know in which order you would like me to tell you.
Just whatever.
Well, you know, let me tell you the experiences that I had in my aunt's apartment. The first thing that happened, her husband was also a well-known man. And there were Jewish Muslim informers who used to work together with the Gestapo. And the Gestapo wanted to know who were the rich people. Not necessarily like they came in Poland for notables to kill them, because they looked in the first few days, they looked for rich and notables and like priests and lawyers and doctors, because the idea was to kill the infrastructure of the human intelligentsia, both Polish and Yiddish, right in the beginning. And they did that by using gas ovens. So that is how, you know, they came to look for my grandfather. But when they came to my uncle, they came purely for money. So they arrived in the apartment, three men dressed, civilian dressed, German Gestapo, and they made everybody undress, including the women. And for me, a little boy who was used to very modest behavior, it was quite a shocking experience to see my young cousin of 18 being, you know, the Germans pulling up her dresses and pulling down her underwear and abusing her, you know, and doing things like that to her. And I think that was one of the first, even the experience when they came to take my father, I didn't see what they did. They just took him away.
We're going to have to take a break now, and we'll pick it up then.
Okay. church. They were really behaving in a very bestial manner. And this was the first time that I actually experienced human beings of that nature. And up to that time that they came, I was again very insulated because we spent, all the windows were broken, you know, from the bombardment in Warsaw, all the windows were broken. And so I spent most of the winter under duvets, you know, these very down, what we used to call in Yiddish perenes, and it comes from the Polish word piezina. And that's how you could survive because the apartments weren't heated, the frost was there. So we spent, the children spent most of our time lying underneath, and we didn't go out to forage for food. So my mother and I suppose her sister-in-law and my uncle were the ones who tried. And I never remember really being hungry. I remember being very cold, but not hungry. And I hadn't seen any Germans particularly, and I'd been on the train, and there were mostly Poles, and things were just very fluid. But to be subjected, a child of seven, I mean, that's, I had just turned 7 years old, to this type of experience, especially that you were used to before that, to living a very modest, Hasidic, ultra-Orthodox, where everything was orderly, where you lived according to a book which told you how to behave, how to be polite, how to speak to the elderly, and you were brought up continuously, not only by your parents, but your grandparents brought you up. You know, your rebbe, your teacher, everybody was teaching you how to be a human being. And they, in kind of one fell swoop, you were turned over and you were kind of become part of some kind of a bestiality, treated like a beast, worse than a beast. And I think it was from that time on that I started retreating into myself. And I became almost like this video machine. I became a onlooker and recorder of events that was happening. And also I think that the experience, that first experience of being subjected to this kind of inhuman behavior somehow insulated me for the future. In other words, I was like inoculated to a certain extent because I was seven and I was given this burst of bestiality in a very concentrated form. So what happened later, which was unbelievable horror, but it somehow did not have that shattering effect. Because the shattering effect was done previously. That was the beginning of it. And it was a continuous degradation. But the continuous degradation was, I had some defense. And so...
So you were obviously, the family was now living under the German thumb?
Yeah.
And then that was
the beginning. And after that, we were left alone by the Germans. I think they took away my uncle's whatever they could find. And we stayed there until my father came. My cousin, who had turned 18 when the war broke out, she had just finished gymnasium. So she had all these Polish books and so forth and so on. And I started from one end of the bookcase and I went through all her books. And that's what I spent my days. I did not go out until my father came. I might have gone out with my mother for a little bit, but most of the time was spent in the apartment. Most of the time was spent reading. I was a voracious reader, and I spent most of my time reading Polish books, which was unusual.
When you went out, did you go out as a Polish Gentile or?
They didn't, in the beginning, they didn't, we didn't have to wear stars. So when you went out, you were just, the decrees came in kind of slow manner. They came right through 1940, but they didn't start off. In the first few months, everything was like, they had all kinds of things, the Jews must do this on that, but they weren't, not everything was being enforced. And I don't remember what time you had to wear the armband. In Warsaw, there were no yellow stars. In Warsaw, we wore armbands with the Magen David. And I think children in the beginning didn't have to wear it. I'm not sure, but because I don't remember wearing one for quite some time. And I remember later on, after my father came, I used to roam the streets and go to the park and stuff like that, and see Germans marching and playing in the park. You know, they had orchestras, military bands that used to play. So for a while, I kind of roamed the streets. Once spring came, and after my father came, I suppose I felt a little more secure, I started roaming the streets. But my father didn't like that. And he also didn't like it that I wasn't getting a Jewish education. So he found a teacher for me to go on a daily basis and to study the Talmud. So I spent at least half a day in a small apartment where this teacher lived. And he had another one or two boys that would come at the same time. And we would just sit around and we would study a tractate of the Talmud. I don't remember which one. It was Nadarim, because I started the original one. When you're a little boy, you start Buma Metzia. But I started. But when I was in the Warsaw Ghetto, I was considered sufficiently advanced to be able to study Nadarim, which is a much later tractate. And in the Warsaw Ghetto.
You're in the Warsaw Ghetto now, or
no. I'm not yet in the ghetto. We moved. I'm still staying in my uncle's place until my father found the apartment. Now we moved into the apartment late in 1940. I don't remember exactly when. Chronologically, I won't be able to tell you things exactly. I've got vivid memories, but they're not chronological. And once we moved into the apartment, I started going to this teacher, and slowly the Germans started enclosing the ghetto, because the ghetto wasn't enclosed in one go. They started building the walls, they started moving Jews into different areas, and I don't remember exactly when the walls were closed. There may have been beginning of 41, but I think it was when it was completely enclosed. But fortunately for us at the time, the apartment that my father found was in the ghetto. And it so happened it was in the ghetto until the end. Because they once or twice made the ghetto smaller. You know, originally the ghetto was much bigger, and then they condensed people and took away a few more streets. But we had been in an apartment where the ghetto was inside the ghetto and was there forever. You know, until the ghetto was destroyed. And I spent my time in the Warsaw Ghetto. First, my father had this little shop, and I spent my time hanging around the shop after I came back from the teacher. The teacher didn't last very long. Either my parents couldn't pay him, or it became so dangerous to teach Talmud, because this was something that the Germans outlawed. They outlawed all teaching. You know, schools were completely, and all teaching was done underground in the Warsaw Ghetto. I'm not sure in the beginning how it worked, but I know afterwards you couldn't. So I'm not quite sure how long I went to the teacher, but I don't think it was too long. And I spent my time, from the time we moved into the apartment until the 21st of July 1942, which was when they brought out the edict that all Jews were going to be resettled from the Warsaw Ghetto to the east. And I remember reading those placati, the announcement, the affiches on the wall. I spent my time in the streets of the Warsaw Ghetto observing. I don't know what I was doing, but I was looking at everything. I didn't understand half the things. I saw people in shops buying cakes while outside people were dying of hunger. I saw halls where people were dancing, where outside the Jewish police were beating and pushing people towards going to German occupied positions on the other side of the wall for work. I saw Germans coming in and doing most terrible things to people in the streets, beating them up, cutting Jewish people's beards off, tearing hair out of their head. And somehow or other, I was never touched. Nobody ever laid a hand on me in the Warsaw Ghetto. Either I was unseen, or I'm beginning to think that my, you know, blonde hair and blue eye had something to do with it. And my so-called Aryan features. And I would go home. I'd get up in the morning. When I was still studying, I would go there. After that, I would spend time in the street. I would see women patrolling the streets and walking off with men and coming back in and out without knowing what it's all about. And I didn't know for years, even after the war, and only after the war in England, that I found out that these were prostitutes. And I was looking at people enjoying themselves. And I saw people dying in the streets and being covered with newspapers. I saw the cart coming and collecting people from the streets. So I was like a street boy. And from time to time, I helped my father in the shop, but that didn't last very long. Then he started making wine in our kitchen from raisins. And I would take it to wherever he told me to take it. And this was Kiddush wine for Shabbos. My mother was baking challahs, and I would deliver those. Where they got the flour from, where they got the raisins, how they managed to do this, I don't know. Whether they were poor or not in the Warsaw Ghetto, I can't say, because they had a lot of valuables. But I think some of those valuables, and that is, I'll tell you the story later, but I'm anticipating those valuables belonged, I think, some of it to my grandfather, some to my grandfather, my mother's side, some to maybe other members of the family. And my father was a strictly honest man. And I don't think that he would have used gold or diamonds or coins or anything of value that didn't belong to him. So he may have been struggling. I'm not quite sure. And after the war, this cousin that survived, he was a grown-up person with a wife and child. His daughter was 4 years younger than me, so she was really still an infant in the Warsaw Ghetto. He told me that often he would come and tell my father, say, Mendel, why don't you sell something and you can improve your lot? But he wouldn't. He would say, it's not mine, it doesn't belong to me. And that's so obviously he must have had some, but he had to do all kinds of things to be able to survive, because he wasn't using wealth that I will tell you the sad story about afterwards. And this lasted to 1942 in July. In July, the Germans decided to start the death factories working for the Warsaw Jews. I mean, we didn't know that at the time immediately, but everybody was very aware that whatever is going to happen when you move out of Warsaw is not going to be good. And in the beginning, you know, the Germans had this business about these could stay and these could go, and if you worked here, you didn't have to be resettled, and if you didn't work, and they were doing this on a kind of slow basis. By that time, there must have been over half a million Jews in Warsaw Ghetto, because they pulled in all the people from all over, from the little towns, and they pushed them into the Warsaw Ghetto. They also brought Jews from Germany. I remember, you know, German Jews coming to the Warsaw Ghetto in passenger trains and trying to find a place where to live in the Warsaw Ghetto, and they couldn't understand why they were pushed into this hellhole when they were better type of Jews, or they regarded themselves being better type of Jews.
Certainly there wasn't enough accommodation in the ghetto for all these people, was there?
It was horrendous. I mean, I remember my father taking in, we actually had an elderly gentleman or middle-aged gentleman who was covered with sores living in our kitchen, and my mother was very concerned about the children because she felt that he was ill and that the children would get ill. But my father said, you know, we can't turn him out. He hasn't got a place to be. So as long as we stayed in the apartment, not to right to the end, because he disappeared And it's amazing where I found him afterwards, but that's another story. He disappeared halfway through the resettlement program. And my father did not believe a word the Germans said. And although my cousin, the one that survived the war, was very in with the authorities, because he was one of these kind of survivors, fixers. He could do what he wanted. He really was a very capable man. And he had connections, and he would bring all the papers. They used to call it the Eisner Papieren, because there were these papers that nobody would touch you if you had them. But my father didn't believe it. So what we did, he would lock us up, and he would not let us go out. And we were kind of like semi-hidden right from the beginning. We did not venture out. We did not do anything. And so for the first few months, there were sufficient people in the streets and all over that they didn't really go from door to door looking for people. So if you didn't push yourself, and if you weren't on any list that they come and fetched you, or if your building wasn't one that they were kind of chasing everybody out of, and even if they were, if you locked yourself in, it was mainly the Jewish police that were doing the resettling. You didn't open a door; they didn't bother to worry about it. It was only later, when they started putting quotas on Jewish policemen. In other words, they had to bring a certain amount of people on a daily basis, because Jews started hiding. And what's more, by that time, after a few months, everybody knew in the Warsaw Ghetto that we were going to die, that they were sending us to death factory. It was not a secret. Some people didn't want to believe it, but I remember as a child, you know, I mean, by that time, this was 1942, and I was much older, I remember very clearly that we knew about Treblinka. We knew because people from the Zionist movement had smuggled themselves onto the trains and went and came back. How they did it, God only knows. I think in the beginning, when there was these huge transports going, the Germans weren't so careful, and these were very brave young men and women. So they came back and they told the story. In the beginning, I don't think people would believe them, but it started permeating. And they started looking at it, like we were supposed to be resettled to the east, very far away, and the same trains with the same numbers would leave in the morning and come back in the afternoon. So they knew it wasn't very far. And I suppose they had contacts with Polish and Jewish resistance. So they found out exactly that we were going to Treblinka.
Treblinka, I think it was just north of the city of Warsaw, wasn't it?
I don't know, actually. I never looked it up. I really don't. I don't. I find it even difficult today to find out exactly what it's all about. You know, from the point of view of physical, I've never been back to Poland. I don't want to go back to Poland. And I find it physically impossible even to kind of think in terms of being a physical entity. And it costs me too much.
So you were in the ghetto, and they started reducing and liquidating the ghetto.
Yeah.
And
as soon as the first... There were like three periods of resettlement, main resettlement period. There was the first one, which lasted several months, and there was a lull. And then they started the second one. By the time the second one came, my father had arranged with certain people in our building, and they built in the roof a hiding place. And the moment we heard that something Germans or Jewish police coming, we would all go and hide. And one man, the superintendent, the Jewish superintendent of the building, would had a small hideout somewhere else, and he would put us in that room and cover it with there was a wall, a false wall, and in front of the false wall there were all kinds of old furniture and stuff like that, and we would stay there until it was safe to come out, you know. And in the evening, the Germans didn't come at night. It was very rare that it came at night. So most of the time we were either being hidden or sleeping in our apartment. And at the first alarm, we had lookouts, and it was really, I would say, very well organized. In our particular building, this superintendent was a kind of a strong man. I mean, we would call him a gibbor, but in English, I suppose you would say the strong man, a hero, in the sense that he organized everybody. He knew what to do and how to do it. And I would like to recount to you a Kol Nidre night. Towards the end of 1942, the Kol Nidre night, we were all the men, not the women, just the men and the boys, were in that hiding place. And my father took his talus and he covered his in my face, and he held me to him. And they started calling her and they started crying. I didn't last out on my feet, but they stood for 24 hours, not moving from their place, crying, beseeching Providence to help the Jewish people. The same day, while we were hiding, that roof had slats on the outside, but it was like slatted like this wall here, except you could, if you put your eye to it, you could actually see outside. And the Germans always found the best time to kill Jews was on Yom Tovim, on holidays, Jewish holidays. And they rounded up a lot of people. We were on a corner, on Corner Nalevki, I don't remember what the street was that ran that way. And they rounded up a lot of people. It was quite cold at the time. And they were shooting them in the street. And they made the Jewish police that were like around there helping them round up these people. Why they were shooting them on the spot, I have no idea. Maybe they were resisting or whatever, as an example. So they shot several hundred people in that particular spot where we were looking out. And I was, while they were praying, the machine guns and the rifles were going all the time. And then when they left, what is stuck in my mind is the corpses looking like logs of wood, because that they were stacked up like logs of wood. And I don't know how to even begin to explain the feelings that were going through of the other people. I know that I was completely paralyzed. I don't think that, I was like a mouse caught, and hypnotized by a cat and can't move, or an animal caught in the headlights in the night of a motor car and doesn't know to go this way or that way. That's how I felt. In French, there's a good word called coincé. And and this went on, hiding and being in the apartment and foraging for food for quite a while. And then the second resettlement stopped. And I didn't know at the time why, but I know now is because there was the uprising in Treblinka and the crematoria were burned down and all kinds of things were happening, and the trains didn't run. Or for whatever reason, the Germans, I once described it, that the death machine choked on itself. And and that went on until Erev Pesach in 1943.
Which is when the uprising commenced?
And that's when the uprising commenced. But by that time, we had dug bunkers. And we weren't anymore in the hiding in the roof, because the Germans were going around with flamethrowers and doing all kinds of things to buildings. And this superintendent and the men and whoever was the decision makers decided that they would use the part that was destroyed in the Warsaw bombing, when the Germans bombed it in 1939, under those ruins, they were going to build a bunker. And they dug down. I think it took them quite a while. But by the time the uprising was there, that bunker had already been ready for a little while. And as a matter of fact, we often, when there was an alarm, we used to spend in that bunker. They'd put food and water. They had in inconspicuous places amongst the ruins, they put chimneys or pipes for breathing because this was underground.
What was your part? Did you have a specific job during the uprising?
Well, I was given a specific job, but I didn't do anything because I don't think I was given all young boys were given lamps and a little kind of opaska, and we were supposed to be runners between the bunkers, you know, the fighting bunkers. That was before the actual uprising started. Once the uprising started, we went down to the bunker, and except for getting out at night, we never were in daylight hours anywhere except in the bunker. At night, the Germans didn't come into the Warsaw Ghetto, not after the uprising. They immediately, at dusk or whenever, they would move out. In the first few days, they were absolutely surprised by the vehemence of the resistance. But within a week, the main points of resistance were being badly attacked, if I remember correctly. And we were betrayed. I mean, not that it would have made any difference, because eventually we would have had to go down, but there were, again, there were Jews who were caught, and this is hearsay. I can't tell you whether this is true or not, but I was told while we were in the bunker and afterwards in the concentration camps, is that there were Jews who were promised life by the Germans. They were taken onto the Aryan side. They were quartered in some hotel, and they had given them food and women and drink and, you know, and everything of, you know, like for human appetites, which is possible. I don't understand the whole thing. So to this day, I can't kind of believe it. I believe it philosophically. I'm not sure that I can believe it physically, because I don't understand how any Jew could have done it. But we were betrayed, because what happened is at night when we came out of the bunkers, they would mingle with Jews would mingle, and they would like go into the bunker at night in the morning or whenever it was time to get and hide, and the next day they would disappear, and the next day they would bring the Germans. And that's exactly what happened with us. They knew exactly where the hiding place was. They knew exactly where the trap was, because for 3 weeks or 3.5 weeks we were there. We were there for quite a long time, because by the time we left, the ghetto was burning. But there was still fighting going on sporadically, because the Germans were very nervous. And when they said if we don't come out, they'll put gas. They knew exactly where the pipes were, where the vents were. They'll put gas in the vents. And as we were coming out of the bunkers, there was like a line of what looked to me like paratroopers, because they were so heavily armed with machine guns, Schmeisser machine guns hanging from there, and some of them kind of crouching with their machine guns in their hands, and kept on saying, nicht schießen, alles soll sein gut, nicht schießen. That's how they kept on saying. In other words, don't shoot, you'll be okay. Of course, you know, that was just nonsense, but I mean, nobody shot in our bunker, although there were some Jews who had revolvers and who had been participating in the fighting. But I when we were taken out, it was close to evening. I'm not sure why that happened, because they didn't normally do that. But I suppose by that time most of the fighting had died down and they could already operate after dark, because by the time they took us out of the bunker, it was dark. And when they marched us through the streets of the Warsaw Ghetto, there was fire burning on both sides. I mean, I remember going through rivers of fire. We were walking in the middle, and on both sides the buildings were burning. And even then, people would break away from the column and run into the fires, or try and run away. And Germans would shoot after them, and then I don't know whether they shoot seriously or not, because they didn't really worry whether they're running away. But some people would run away, would not be taken.
We're going to stop now for a break.
Okay. We were taken to the resettlement point, which we knew as Stavki. That's what it was called. It was a place where there was a hospital and a siding, and that's where there were buildings there, I think old hospital buildings or government buildings or institutional buildings. I don't remember what they were. But that is where we were congregated, and we were pushed into the building by Ukrainian, Latvian, and Polish auxiliaries who were dressed all in black and were beating us as we were moving up the stairs, and they would push us into a room, let's say like this, where we're sitting in, except they would push in so many people that you couldn't even sit on the floor. You would actually like half kneel on the floor. And I was there with my father, mother, and my sister for 3 nights. And I will just tell you two things that happened. I will not tell you all the things that happened those 3 nights, because obviously what was happening is that these non-German auxiliaries, made up of Ukrainian, Latvian, Lithuanian, Poles, who served in the SS, also wanted to make money. So they would go and say, look, we can take you out if you give us your hidden money or whatever. Have you got any money? And they weren't supposed to do that because the Germans wanted all this money. So there was all this trade going on, and they would take people out and promise them. And then, of course, after they got the money, they would just shoot them in the back, because there was no, the law was the law of the gun. And you could just take any person. The Germans didn't care. The Poles were happy. So the Ukrainians didn't care. So, you know, once you took his money away, you shot him. So that was going on. But what was even worse is the way they came for the women. And I didn't know what they were doing. But I knew they were doing something bad, because they kept on pulling young girls out of the room. And then the young girls would be pushed back in, all beaten and crying and torn. And there I was, and I was looking at that as a boy of 11 years old, just turned 12, I was 11, I was turning 12 in July. And that was in April, May of 1943. And I was looking at this, and I was just, it was almost like filming it. It was going through, and the emotions inside me were just horrendous, because I wasn't just seeing it, I was feeling it. And in the previous tape that I made, I think I conveyed some of the emotional feelings also. And for several months after that, I had nightmares again. And I think that my subconscious does not allow me to actually continue and actually telling you those feelings. Because it's one thing recording and looking, it's another thing, you know, living it. And living while you are actually seeing it, looking at it, and at the same time experience your parents' anxiety, who were sitting next to you, like kneeling and holding you, trying to appease you. And the second thing that I wanted to tell you is the humanity, the courage of Jewish people. I mean, my parents saved a sock with sugar. They had a sock which was filled with sugar. And from time to time, they would take a little bit of sugar and they would give it to the children. They didn't take any. I don't know how they survived those few days, but that's what happened. And that's what stuck in my mind, of this enormous serenity and human feelings in people.
Where did you go to from there? Where were you taken, I should say?
after several days, we were chased in a line. There was a line of soldiers of every denomination, of all the ones I mentioned, Ukrainians, Poles, Latvians, Lithuanians, Germans, Polish police. And each one of them had either a rifle or a stick. And as we were being chased from the room, I think we were on a third floor, down the stairs. On the stairs, they were lined up, and they were beating us all the way. We were running towards the wagons. And as we were running towards the wagons, we were being beaten and pushed into the wagons. And when the wagons were sufficiently filled to the requirements of the Germans, in other words, they were like pushed in so that you could hardly stand, the wagons were closed. The journey lasted quite a long time. We didn't go far. We went to Majdanek. Majdanek is not that far. What's further was further than Treblinka, but because it was near Lublin. But it still wasn't so far, but we traveled a long time. And even if we didn't travel a long time, I remember it was a long time. And I remember people breaking open the bottom of, these were wooden, closed in wooden wagons, breaking open the wagons and trying to get through underneath. Either they were killed or maybe they managed to escape, I don't remember. I remember people dying in the wagon. I remember people urinating, defecating. I remember and that was the journey. When we arrived in Majdanek, we were pushed out of these wagons and immediately we were separated into men and women and then grown-ups and children. My father told me that I must say I'm 18 years old, so I stayed with him. My mother somehow, and I remember that scene, I remember, lost sight of my sister. My sister was kind of pushed towards the children. And although I was pretty tall, and my sister was not much smaller than me, I don't know what happened, but somehow she got like pushed towards the children, and my mother was screaming, and then she went towards, and she wouldn't give up my sister. And so they pushed my mother towards that part where there were children, and a lot of other women went there too. And that's the last time I saw my sister and my mother. Now I'll tell you the story about the treasury that my father had. Why and how he managed to keep it with him, I have no idea. But he kept several boxes of gold jewelry, which I presume belonged to the whole family, gold coins, all kinds of tachshitim. How do you say that? And I always, whenever I speak about those times, what?
Treasure,
yes. I always kind of lapse into Yiddish and to Hebrew because somehow or other I kind of think in those terms. And they buried it. I mean, the fact that it didn't mean anything, they were burying it where we were just hanging around waiting for the Germans to say what we were going to do. And we were told to go to the bar disinfection, which by that time we all knew was the gas chambers. So we thought that we were going to the gas chambers. I mean, I thought I was going to the gas chamber. And we were going to the gas chambers, except they had this type of Mengele doctor telling, you know. But first, before that happened, you went into a room and there were like benches in between, like work benches. It was like it looked like a Trojan horse, but it was something with a top, and in the middle was empty, and that's where you're supposed to take off all your clothes and just throw the clothes on there. My father was next to me, and we undressed, and they told us to keep our belts. I have no idea why. And we started, and then they started chasing us. We started running with our belts up in the air. My father was in front of me. He was there 1 second, and the next second he disappeared. And that was the last time I saw my father. There was a German standing and pushing people this way, that way. I don't know what was going on. For a long time, I didn't even remember it. And I kind of blanked it out. But I remembered this scene some years later. And I was pushed into a room where there were lots of barbers who were shaving you from head to toe. You know, your whole body hair, everything was shaved. And all the time I was thinking, you know, this is the end, you know. And I was just, and then they threw you into a big vat with disinfectant. And they knocked you over the head. Now, I'm retelling this now in a kind of slow manner. This was going on in a most chaotic maelstrom. It was as if you were in the eye of the storm. It was like peace on the outside, but storm on the inside. Or storm on the inside. It's peace on the inside, storm on the outside. I know what was going on. I really didn't know what was happening. But I remember being knocked over the head, so that I suppose my head was sticking out. I didn't want to drown. So somebody knocked me over the head, whether it was a Jewish prisoner or a couple or somebody. And I had to emerge completely. And then I was thrown out of that vat and made to run and gone into a room where there were lots of, you know, water.
Showerheads.
And I was convinced all the time that the next thing is going to happen is going to be gas coming out of there, because we knew in the Warsaw Ghetto what was happening, that there was the whole story of Treblinka we knew before. And water came out. And then we were like showered and we were kicked into another room, and there we were given prison garb, striped prison garb with wooden clogs. And when I came out, I was looking for my father. I didn't find my father, but I found the man who had sores on his face and who had been a lodger in our kitchen for many, many months in Warsaw. And I asked him, "Where's my father?" And he didn't answer. And I started crying, but I wasn't crying because I didn't see my father. I want to be quite honest. I was crying because I was crying. I just didn't know what was going on, and my whole world came to an end. That was the beginning of one part of my life. And I saw that it was finished, that my life was finished there. I mean, even when I came out. And I was crying, and I'm not sure what I was crying for. I was crying for myself, for my father, relief maybe that I wasn't killed. I was just crying. And then I was put into a barracks with, I would say, another 1,000 people, because they were these huge, huge barracks. And there were like 3 or 4 tiers of bunks where people would sleep. And we had a Jewish block eldester. A block eldester was a block leader who was a sadist and who was obviously a absolute schizoid, paranoid, God knows, you name it. He was that, because I didn't know what he was doing. I knew what he was doing, but I didn't know why he was doing. He would hang little boys, but what at night. But of course, he would get little boys, he would abuse them, and then he would hang them. And every morning, when we would wake up, we would see 2 or 3 little boys hanging from the rafters. And he could do it because Majdanek was a law unto itself. And I was in Majdanek for about 3 or 4 months. And one day, and there were selections all the time for the guest chambers. So one day they would say this, and I tried to keep myself busy, so I was always like doing something. I mean, Once I was beaten very badly, and I suffer to this day still from that. But I kind of made myself always busy because there was no real work. You kind of took stones from one place and put them to another place. You like went to this. As long as you didn't go out on a commando, you were pretty safe of not being too brutally beaten. And there were all kinds of small jobs that you had to do. And I managed, for some reason, to always find something doing. Everybody saw that I was doing something. And I survived like that for several months with some help from some Dutch Jews who worked in the kitchens. And I used to go to the kitchen, and from time to time they would give me something extra, you know, to eat. And one day, as usual, they used to look for, they had these elections, so they would say, we want electricians. Lots of people would go, they think, and then they would suddenly be marched off to the guest chambers. They would take out all the week and so forth and so on. And one day they came asking for electricians and builders and this and that and the other. And I, something made me say, well, I'm going to go. And my, those boys that I had befriended said, no, you mustn't go, you know. And I just didn't want to listen. I went. And they put us into a barrack where we made to undress. And I thought, well, yeah, this is the end. And some people tried to get out. And the next thing, there was a doctor. And he perfunctorily examined people, like he put the stethoscope to the heart and the lungs, and then he kind of pushed you this way or that way. Then I was told to get dressed. I got different clothes, not striped clothes. And we were shipped. We were given food, given a bread, sausage, piece of margarine. We got a loaf of bread, small thing of margarine, and a piece of German sausage. And we were dumped into a train, but not like sardines. We could sit. And we were taken to a munition factory in Poland, in a place called Skarżysko Kamienne. And that was a hell camp. There were men there, there were also women. They worked in the munitions. They did the lighter work, the men did the heavier work. And they worked with chemicals. So that those that did the heaviest work and weren't wearing protective clothing, they would slowly be poisoned. And the poison would seep in through them and they would get jaundice. So they would go yellow internally and externally. The saltpeter and the chemicals they were working with would stain them. And they would also somehow or other develop the liver wouldn't function properly, so they would go yellow. And from time to time, these yellow people were being selected and shot. Now, I found a job exploding old munitions, because what they did is they used to bring faulty munitions or munitions that they got from the Poles or from France or whatever, and they would break it, and they would use the gunpowder. So you'd have like separate these anti-aircraft bullets or big things. And one of the things you had to do is that the casing part would have a cap at the end, which would start the powder burning. When you pull on your trigger, that's what you do. You start a small cap that starts the gunpowder burning, and that shoots the bullet out. And those caps, before it went, the copper went again to be had to be
exploded.
So we would put it on kind of like little sticks. You know, there was, you had these little benches on which there were lots of sticks. You would put these, seed them on, and then you'd go with a hammer and explode the little thing. Occasionally there was some powder in and somebody would get injured, and as soon as he would get injured, the German would take him and shoot him. So this is what I did for some time. Then I got ill with typhoid fever, and fortunately for me, I had very good friends, and that again, the humanity that came through amongst bestial conditions, that hid me, gave me extra food, and pulled me through. You know, I had fleck fever. Fleck fever was spotted typhoid. And also a camp policeman, there were camp policemen, Jewish camp policemen, internal, knew my family. He came to Skarżysko from Lodz and he knew my family. And he had his wife there. Apparently they were allowed to have their wives. His wife was very ill. So he asked me to look after his wife. She was lying in bed and she was incontinent and she was dying from TB. And I nursed her. I used to clean her and so forth and so on. And he used to give me extra food for that. And at the end, after about being there for nearly a year, and the war was getting nearer to Skarżysko, the Germans used to evacuate these camps.
What point in time were we at? Yeah.
We are in 44. And in 44, the Germans started evacuating Skarżysko. I would say it was summer of 44. And if you want to know exactly how long I was in these camps, in Yad Vashem in Jerusalem, they actually have got the records. Gives my name,
records.
The record. It gives my name and gives the all the camps I was and the time. I think the duration. I'm not sure about the duration, but gives the and also gives my age as 18. So I actually found it. You know, in when I went to Yad Vashem, I actually found this record.
You weren't 18 at this time.
No, I wasn't. I was, you know, I was 13.
Yes.
I was turning 14. No, I was 13, 1932. I was 13. And no, I was 12. I don't know what I'm talking about. 1943 in July, I turned 12. So 1940, I was 12. I only turned 13 after the war.
So we're now in the
we're now in 1944. Right. The Russians are coming nearer, and the Germans want to evacuate the camp, but they don't want to take anybody that they think can't work. So they announced the Wachmeister, it was Austrian policemen that guarded us. They were recruited from the Viennese city police. And how I know is because I saw pictures of them after the war, and I saw what they wore during the war, so I know exactly where they came from. And they were in charge of us externally, with some Ukrainians, and internally, there was Jewish police, and they did not behave badly, the Jewish police, not in that camp. They did, you know, they took us to work, brought us back to work, they counted us, they gave out the soup, but they didn't, I've never seen anybody beaten by that police or anything like that. They were just like, they called them Ordnungspolizei, and that's what they were. I don't remember seeing them doing anything. I personally didn't see them doing it, and I may be prejudiced because one of the policemen helped me, but I really didn't see it. I remember him getting cross when people used to push in the column to get the food, because he was the guy who stood there with the ladle and dished it out. So he would sometimes go very cross and would like start taking the ladle and trying to ward people off and get them back into line. But that's as far as I've seen him beating. And we had to, that evening, we had to go in front of a little window. And behind that little window sat the Wachmeister, the chief of the camp, and he had a list, and you announced your name, and he made a note next to your name, a sign. And the next morning, they announced that all the people that are going to be called out their names are going to be going with in rail cars, and the others are going to walk. And they started calling out the names. And in the beginning, so the people started forming up, and I went, they called my name out, and I went out. And suddenly there was a kind of panic. And people suddenly started realizing that, you know, this is when the Germans start doing something, you mustn't listen. And I remembered what my father did, that he didn't. So I started running, where can you run? And the barracks were built in such a way, there was a tiny little kind of like space you know, between the concrete and the rubble and the foundations, that you could kind of squeeze yourself in. So I squeezed myself in there, and but everybody started running away. And that was the end of the name calling, because people wouldn't say, everybody ran in the camp and they went back into the barracks, and the Germans didn't know what to do. So they didn't do anything for a while, and then they sent out the Jewish police to reform the groups, and they were going to do a selection without names, because they already knew that people would call out the names, they're not going to, and they didn't know who was who, how could they, when there were thousands of people in the camp, several thousand men and women. So the Jewish police started looking for everybody, and this policeman that I looked after, his wife, pulled me out from under the barrack. And he told me, his name was Katz, I remember his name well, and he told me that there's no point in me hiding, because they'll pull me out and they'll kill me. And he says, they're going to make a selection, and those people that are selected are going to die, but I'm going to do something which maybe will help you. And he took me into the barracks where the elders lived, the people that had been there right from the beginning, those that were allowed to have their wives. And they were specialists, like, you know, tool makers and die makers, people that the Germans really needed and wanted. They used to make all the tools and dies, and they had their wives with them. So they had normal clothes and they were well dressed. So he took me in and he dressed me with high boots, riding boots, and proper, I had smart tutim. I had, like, everything was torn on me. I was wrapped in paper and shmatas, you know, in torn clothing. And he gave me complete new clothing. And then he did something which, again, you know, this is something that you remember because you think, well, that was the last touch maybe that saved your life. And he took a woman's lipstick and he rubbed it into my cheeks so that I should look healthier. And he took me out and he said, look, you have to go in because there's no point in you hiding. They'll find you eventually. It's better. Just take your chance and stay there. So when they found everybody, we stood there for quite a few hours. The Germans put a ring of Austrian police with machine guns around us. And the Wachmeister started going row to row and pulling people out. And I stood in the front row, and next to me stood my best friend, also a young boy, and he had an impediment. He was strong and everything, but he had one club foot. He used to drag his foot. And the German got to him, and he pulled him out, and then he passed over me, and he went further. And that was another kind of like, I want to call it a milestone, but it wasn't a milestone. It was a milestone in reverse. It was, again, a kind of horrendous experience I felt that I was executed because I felt guilty, because I felt relieved that I wasn't taken. My best buddy went through the most atrocious things together, was pulled out, and I knew he was going to be shot. So that was that.
I think now is a good time to take a break.
Okay.
We've got one more tape, and I don't
cars and shipped to another camp in Częstochowa, into a factory which was called Żelazna Huta. It was an iron works where they used to convert raw iron and scrap into pig iron, and we would work there, and we would, you know, lift up those ingots of iron and load wagons. That was my work. We had to load a wagon a day of pig iron, and the pig iron was produced there in forms. It had a rectangle shape, and it was, I can't remember how much it weighed, but it was quite a heavy, you know, piece of cast iron, pig iron, and we spent the time daily doing that. The camp was it was like an oasis, because when we arrived there, the Jewish leader of the camp told us that we will be looked after, and that we don't have to worry, that as long as we are there, he's going to see to it that we're going to get reasonably fed, and he's going to get us clothes, and he kept all those promises. I mean, so much so that one of the boys got ill, and he managed to bribe people to send him to the hospital in Częstochowa, and that child came back and was actually healed. He had to have an appendix operation. And this was like, to me, it was another milestone, because it was like going from one hell to a kind of paradise. It really was. But it didn't last very long, because I was there only for several months. And the Russians were getting nearer again. What I found out after the war, I didn't know it at the time, is that we were sold like the Schindler Juden. We were sold to a German concern, and they didn't like to give up their workers because they paid for them, and they needed them wherever they went. So we didn't have a Schindler, but we had Germans who wanted to use us as long as we could give, because they didn't care whether we died or not. When we died, we died, or when we were killed, we were killed. There was nobody making lists or anything like that. But for as long as we were alive, we belonged to them, and they paid for us, they wanted us to produce. But somehow or other, we were loaded onto trains from Częstochowa, and we sat in those trains for like 2 weeks. There were no guards, no nothing. We were like being shunted in Germany from this siding to that siding. We stopped at sidings where there were Hungarians coming back from the Russian front, wounded. We scavenged food, because we weren't given any food, from German soldiers and others. And somehow or other, they didn't pay attention who we were, or whether we were Jews or we weren't Jews. It was like terribly chaotic. I mean, you must remember, this was the end of 1944. But after several weeks on sidings, one day the locomotive kind of took us to the gates of Buchenwald. And again, we finished in some hell. And I won't describe you the hell of Buchenwald, because Buchenwald was a place where you were left to rot. If you can imagine the hellhole of Calcutta, that was Buchenwald, except worse. Because you went to sleep in the barrack, and in the morning you had to take out 20, 30 people that died in the night, and you had to roll them up, and you were counted together with the dead. And until the dead were counted and carted off to the crematorium, they had to be alive. So if they died in the afternoon, until the next appel, they were lying inside the barrack. If they slept next to you, you couldn't do anything with them, because the block elses, they saw to it that you didn't touch them, you know, until they had to be counted or whatever. So sometimes they allowed you to take them out and line them out in the barracks. Sometimes they didn't, depending whether, you know, they locked you up for the night or whatever. Like, once you were locked in the barracks, you weren't allowed to go out. So this was going on in Buchenwald. And we fought for raw potatoes, because occasionally they used to distribute some food. Now, how I survived the 3 months in Buchenwald, I have no idea. I mean, nobody beat you. You were in a kind of impossible hellhole. Nobody gave you proper food. Occasionally there was some watery soup being distributed, occasionally some raw potatoes, occasionally a piece of bread was divided by 12 people, 20 people, 18 people. And this went on, and I didn't have a sense of time, and you were getting weaker and weaker. One day they started, And they used to call out names, and I didn't know at the time that they were calling out names of allies to shoot them, because they had also allied soldiers there in Buchenwald locked up. And when you were called to the tower, you like knew that you were going to be killed or something like that. And one day, they were calling up all kinds of names, and I recognized all the names of the people that I worked with for quite some time. And we were told to come to the tower. So we came to the tower, and an official of Hasak, I don't know what Hasak stood for, but this was the factory that we belonged to. They said that let's go to work. They were looking for us all over, and we must go to work.
This is the factory that you were in previous to Buchenwald.
Yeah, the Skarżysko. Right. You know, the Skarżysko, Częstochowa. Once we were out of Majdanek, we went to work for these people. And they came looking for us in Buchenwald, or looking, I suppose they were told, and they told us they needed us. So we were taken and transferred to a place called Kolditz. Now, Kolditz is a very famous place because there were generals housed in a castle near Kolditz, but there were also factories, and we were housed actually in the factories making Panzerfaust. Panzerfaust was a kind of bazooka, an anti-tank weapon, very primitive one, that two soldiers used to fight. One used to hold it on his shoulder, and the other one used to shoot. Often, it used to kill the soldiers because a very primitive German anti-tank weapon, which they kind of, this was one of the Gewalt, you know, kind of what the new weapons that Hitler promised is going to wipe out the German Allied tanks and stuff like that. So, again, I was very fortunate that when we arrived there, they wanted to know who are the Buben. And of course, you never admitted that you were a child. But I'm not quite sure what made me do it. I was the only one who kind of stepped out, and I said to the SS sergeant, he was an elderly man, he was like 50-something. I don't know, he didn't look particularly kindly, but I said, I'm a Bub, ich bin ein Bub.
So he said, what exactly is a Bub?
A Bub is a young boy. So he marched me off to work in the kitchen. And of course, in the kitchen, you were still under the supervision of SS orderlies, and you had to be very careful. But where you were, you know, peeling potatoes, because we were cooking for the Germans too, you know, you could eat some raw potatoes, you could eat some carrots. You got extra soup anyway from the kitchen, because that was because you worked there. The orderly would give you, and he would give you from the bottom, so there was some meat in it, and so forth and so on. And yeah, I even helped a friend of my father's who survived the war and became a Rosh Yeshiva. He was also a Chosid. He was a friend, very close friend of my father's from Lodz, who I found in Częstochowa from Lodz. And he wasn't in Buchenwald. Somehow or other, I don't know how he got to Kolditz in a different way. And we met up in Kolditz, and I used to occasionally, because I ate enough in the kitchen, I would give him what I used to get in the barrack, in the factory, I would give him my share. And that helped him. And that went on for several months, and this is now 1945. In April, in beginning of April 95, we were marched by foot from Kolditz to Theresienstadt. That was one of those death marches that you've heard of, where
Theresienstadt is in Czechoslovakia.
Czechoslovakia.
And where is Kolditz in relation?
It was several weeks walking. But we walked sometimes far, sometimes not, because whoever was left behind was shot. And when I was working in the kitchen, at that time the Germans already had no food. This SS sergeant made me do something that could have meant the loss of my life, because he made me steal food from the kitchen for him. He gave me a paper bag and a kind of handbag, which I would steal potatoes and whatever I could lay my hands on and put it inside the bag and leave it near the door, and he would come once a day or whenever, and he would collect that, take it home. Now, if I was caught by the orderly stealing food, you know, if you sit and you ate something, you know, like you could always swallow quickly, but you weren't allowed to do all these things. That's why you got this extra food. He would shoot you. You know, that was the penalty for everything was death. I mean, there was no, they didn't play around. So, while we were marching, he actually repaid what I did for him. I'm not sure why I did that. But we didn't get any food except for the first, we got a bread, we got margarine, and we got sausage, and we got something else. I think some, I don't know, something else. And cheese, we got a piece of cheese. And we started marching, and we were 1 or 2 days in our march, we came to a forest, and the, we had a Polish Unterscharführer, a corporal in the SS, and he spoke Polish and he spoke German, and he regarded himself as what they called a Volksdeutscher. Anyway, he was in the SS. And he came and he said, the Americans are near, and I'm going to change my clothes, and you mustn't, you're not free, we mustn't say I'm going to become one of the prisoners, you know, I treated you nicely, and you know, I started talking like that. And don't say that I am worried I'm going to hide between the prisoners and this and that and the other. And they started changing. And of course, we were just lying there and people started eating their food because they, the German, the Americans are going to come. You don't have to keep this bread. And I mean, there wasn't a big bread, which is one piece, one loaf. It was a loaf of bread. And suddenly at about 11 o'clock at night, we were just lying around in this forest. A platoon of SS arrived on motorbikes. They started shooting above our heads, and they told everybody to lie with their face down into the ground. So we lay with the face down to the ground, and we lay like that all night. And the next morning, we were surrounded and marched off. Apparently, the Americans must have not come near enough, so we continued our march. And while we were on this march, anybody that fell out was killed. And this German sergeant, who he was the only one, I think he was in charge of the column, of that particular column which I was involved, because there were many columns, and he had a bike. He was the only one. The other guards also walked. And he would kind of go with his bike backwards and forwards. And from time to time, they would shoot hare and cats and dogs, I don't know what, and they would roast them and go to farmers and force them to give them potatoes. And occasionally he would give me some food. And by that time we weren't getting any food. And I wouldn't get much from him, but he would like give me half a potato, and then occasionally he would give me some bones, you know, to chew. But most of the time we existed on whatever we could lay hands on, leaves. We found grain in a place where we lay. There were sacks of grain, and we started eating the raw grain and filling up our pockets, and we would chew this grain, and all kinds of things. And we actually marched through Dresden after it was bombed. So if you want to put a date on it, you can, because you can find out when Dresden was bombed. And it was a couple of days, because it was still smoking. Everything was still smoking when we went past Dresden. And by that time, and all the time, we were being attacked by the civilian population in terms of they would throw things at us. I don't know what the German guards were thinking, because I suppose they had befailed, so they had to deliver us someplace that they didn't allow the Germans to come too near to us, but they would throw at us stones and stuff like that, abuse us. And then when we crossed the Czech border, it changed. You know, the population, immediately they saw prisoners going through a village, they would throw food from the windows. And what the Germans did is, the moment somebody threw something from a window, they would shoot their machine guns into the window. So it was like, to the bitter end, they would not give up their bestiality. And after several weeks of marching, we arrived, I would say less than half of the people that set out, we arrived in Theresienstadt. And a couple of weeks after that, I was liberated by the Russians. I don't think that I will tell you what happened in Theresienstadt. There were lots of terrible things happening in a couple of weeks that I was there. It is too painful for me to talk about it, and I don't even think I said that in the last tape I did. But I remember the day of liberation, and I think that is very, it's a very important thing to say, because it's palpable, and it's I remember it very clearly. When the Russians came into Theresienstadt and they opened the gates and started coming in, and we were free, we rushed out into the field, because it was the first time that we tasted freedom, that we could actually rush out of the of the gate. So everybody was rushing out. I mean, you didn't know why you were rushing out, but you just rushed out. And we went to the highway, you know, that was passed by Theresienstadt, and there were these long columns of civilian Germans being chased out from Czechoslovakia. And they were on foot, and they were on wagons, horse-drawn wagons, and hand wagons, and on bikes. And all the time that they were moving, the Russians and Czechs and the same gendarmes who were guarding us the day before were abusing the Germans. You know, the Czech gendarmes that were the guards of Theresienstadt concentration camp, they were now abusing these Germans. And I felt sad and sorry. I felt absolutely, I was so devastated in seeing other people being, and I couldn't relate that they were doing this to Germans. I somehow, to me, I was seeing people being, you know, killed and maimed and raped, and I was just so terribly sad. And I kind of was surprised to myself. I said to myself, but these are Germans. But it didn't matter. The sense of compassion, of knowing that this was being done to you, and now you're seeing it done to somebody else, it just didn't matter. I couldn't tolerate this type of what was going on. And some of the other boys and girls that, you know, survived the what he called, we were talking about it that evening, and we were so surprised that we actually didn't go and participate. So that was the day of liberation.
And where did you go to from Theresienstadt?
Well, we were in Theresienstadt for quite a long time. We were in Theresienstadt until the end of August. And then August we were taken to, they wanted to know where we wanted to go, because we could choose either to be repatriated to Poland. We had a Russian Jewish general coming and talking to the prisoners, ex-prisoners, to say that we should all go to Russia because Uncle Stalin is going to look after us, and we, especially the youngsters, we're going to be join the youth league, and we are going to have a different life, and we're going to grow up productive workers, and I don't know what the, and most of us, and this is, I've got on those documents, we were asked, when we were filling out the documents, a desired destination, Palestine. So there was a problem. They couldn't take us to Palestine because the British didn't want us. So we were in the camp for quite a while, till August. And in August, we were actually taken to Prague by UNRWA. I think it was UNRWA. And the RIF brought Lancaster bombers. There's one like that in Toronto on the harbor front. I saw it for the first time since I flew in one, you know, in front of me. When I went walking on the harbor front, I actually saw the bomber. And I told my wife, this is the bomber that I came to England from Czechoslovakia. And we were taken to Windermere, which was a place to rehabilitate us, where we were in ex-officer training camps, and each child and each person, there were children, mostly children, we had a little room to ourselves, and they were playing fields, and there was a theater, and they were just taught us English.
Were you aware at this time if any of your relatives?
No, I didn't know that anybody survived. No, I only learned about the survival of my relatives quite a long time afterwards, because I went through the lists. Yeah, they had lists, and I didn't find any names on the lists, but my name was on a list that this cousin that I told you the story,
yes,
in, what you got, that he found me, and it took him a while to trace where I was, and he only found me in 1947. And of course from him I got, you know, the...
Where were you at the time?
In England.
In England?
Yeah.
And how long did you remain in England?
I stayed in England after the war for 3 years.
And then?
Then I went to join my cousin. They lived in Paris at the time. And I stayed with them for 3 years. I subsequently, and I worked all the time, and I saved enough money, I bought myself a ticket, and I went to Israel. And when I got off the ship, I said to the passport officer, that I would like to know where the nearest recruiting camp is for the Israeli army. And we were speaking Yiddish, and he said, "Was brennt?" That was his answer. What's burning? Yeah, why do you have to run to the army? He says, "Look around, see if you like it. Don't like it, you can go back to France." He says, "You know, it's not heaven on earth here." I said, no, you must tell me where it is. So eventually he told me, and I went and I joined the army immediately. I stayed in the army for, I think, about 3 years, because I stayed a few months longer than I had to. I stayed, you know, normally 2.5, and I said they didn't have anybody to replace me, so they asked me to stay on for a while.
What year was this now?
This was end of 1950, beginning of 51.
So Israel was a state at the time?
Yes. I had turned 18. I couldn't do it before because I wasn't my own. Until I turned 18, I had always all kinds of, I was under the auspices of this one or that one. I was a child. But once I turned 18, I could do what I want. So I went and bought myself a ticket, went to Israel. I went on a boat called the Negba. It was a passenger cargo boat which used to ply between Marseille and Tel Aviv, and it would stop all kinds of ports. It would stopped in Italy, stopped in Greece. It went stopped all over. It was a regular kind of like cargo passenger vessel.
And how long did you remain in Israel?
I was in Israel till after the Sinai campaign, 1956. And in 56, I went back to England.
And then?
And then I got married in England. And
to a British?
No, to a South African, and which I had met in Israel, and we got married. I went to South America. I stayed in England for a while, but I went to South America for a year, and then after a year, my mother-in-law and my wife, when she was pregnant with our second child, she decided she wanted to go back to South Africa home, and I didn't have. You know, I didn't have anybody. I didn't particularly want to go back to South Africa for reasons, but I went, and that's where I got stuck. And I lived in South Africa until I came to Canada in 1985.
And what were you doing by way of occupation?
I started a small finance company, very small.
In South Africa?
Yeah. I borrowed money, and first I did it on a very, very small scale, and slowly I worked hard, I built it up, and I became a financier. I did all kinds of financial dealings.
And you continued that in Canada when you came?
I continued for some time in Canada.
And you have children?
I have 3 children.
Ultimately, how many of your relatives did you find survive?
I found 4 cousins.
And
I found my cousin and his wife and their daughter, and I found another 2 cousins, my first cousins, Leibel Lipske, who is still alive, lives in Israel, and another cousin, Shifra, who also survived the camps. She remarried a much older man in Israel, also very religious. They were all religious. And she died some years ago. And from the 4 cousins that survived, there's only, those apart from myself, and I was much younger because my grandmother had 13 children, of which only 5 survived. So the difference between my father and my eldest aunt was something like 20 years. And some of my cousins were, like 20 when I was born. So there was this, some of my cousins I called uncles because they were much older. So of those 4 cousins that survived together with me, only 1 is alive. The other 3 are deceased. And the daughter, Therese, she's a professor at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. And so very close relations, I've only got my 2nd cousin, Therese, and Leibel, and his family that he built up after the war.
And are there any friends or acquaintances that that you made in the camps, in the various camps that you were, that you keep
yes,
in contact
with? We have kept in touch. We are called the 45 AIDS Society. All the children that came to England, there were about 750 children. he formed a society called the 45-8 Society. And the reason why we call it 45, because of the Day of Liberation. And this society has annual meetings, and we keep in touch continuously. We have a brochure that is brought out, and we collect money to help refugees as a kind of not a payback, but a kind of as a mark of our respect for other refugees. We try and collect money yearly to help people of all races, Jews, non-Jews, color, doesn't matter, skin color, doesn't matter. As long as you're a refugee, we feel empathy with you and we help you out. And we are having the 50th anniversary of our liberation in London, to which I'm going to. We're having that, it's being organized. Some of us live in Canada. I found quite a few of us live in Canada. From time to time we meet together. And some of the ones in England, I'm a very close friend. And in Israel, I've got some very close friends who survived the war with me. As a matter of fact, there is a very well-known rabbi in Gateshead, Rabbi Kamyonka, who actually went through, I knew him in Warsaw, and he went through all the camps together with me.
After such an active life, how do you keep yourself busy today?
In my personal capacity, I think I do what we decided to do jointly. I try and help people. I have been involved for the last 18 years working for mainly the aged, but not necessarily the aged. I am a chaplain, an honorary chaplain. I am the honorary Jewish chaplain of the Toronto Jail. I am the chaplain of the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, which is a long-term care hospital. I help people wherever I can. I have been working at Bakerist for the last 8 years. At the moment, I'm the president of the Men's Service Group. I'm on the board of the Bakerist Center Foundation, and so forth and so on. I've worked on the Toronto Mayor's Committee on Aging. I was the chair of the Advocacy Center for the Elderly, which is a quasi-government legal aid for the aged. It's an agency, which I'm still on the board even today. And wherever I can, I kind of try and alleviate other people's suffering as much as I can. That's I would say, as I'm getting older, I am contributing more and more of my time to that aspect of what I regard as humanism, humanity.
One concluding question. Would you have done anything different?
I don't think it was my choice.
You're a fatalist.
I don't know. I'm a religious person. I'm not a fatalist. I believe in divine providence, whatever the divine providence is. I believe in Jewish humanism. I believe that the first humanist that walked this earth was Avraham Avinu. He was the first person that was concerned about other human beings. He was the first one to take on a deity and say, listen, you can't destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And he started arguing with God. There are 50 righteous people there, you're going to destroy the whole world. But he was concerned for others. And I would say that is the beginning where, you know, that's the beginning of Judaic culture. And it went on like that. And we don't have time on this tape, but if you want to, I could give you 1,001 examples. Both, and I would like to finish about something which I feel very strongly. You know, a lot was made after the war that Jews didn't resist. They went to slaughter. I witnessed in Koldists a camp of Russians, people who were trained soldiers, and they didn't resist. But that's not what I'm going to tell you. What I'm going to try and tell you is that I believe that the heroic resistance of Jews in the camps, in staying human beings right through and continuing after the war, I think this is the greatest act of heroism that you could ever wish for.
And with that, I think we have to conclude.
Okay.